The absolute maximum that a function has is the largest y value that a function obtains on its domain. So in the graph below, the absolute maximum occurs right here. This is the highest y value of all the y values on this graph. Similarly, the absolute minimum for this picture occurs right here at the endpoint. That's the very lowest y value that the graph obtains. Now, local maximums and minimums are a little bit harder to define. A local maximum is a place where the graph is highest for all the points nearby. So this right here is a local maximum, and this right here is a local maximum. This is sort of a local maximum, but usually we don't treat endpoints as local maximums. Similarly, a local minimum is the lowest point nearby. So this is a local minimum, and this is also a local minimum. There can be multiple local or absolute maxes. Here, there is a local max at each of these places, and that is also the absolute max. The absolute max of cosine has a y value of 1. And similarly, there's lots of local mins, and that is also the value of the absolute min. For x squared, there is a local min and an absolute min at 0. There is no local maxes and no absolute maxes. For x cubed, again, it flattens out right here, but there's no local or absolute maxes or mins because the function just keeps going up. So if we want to actually locate all the local maxes and mins, how would we do this? How do you know if you found a local max or min? Can we see if they all have some kind of property in common? If we have this is a local min, this is a local max. This one doesn't have any. This one doesn't really have any. This is a local min. This one doesn't have any. So what do these all seem to have in common? Well, they all seem to be where the graph flattens out before turning a corner, or where the tangent line has a slope of 0. Now notice that this one has a tangent line with a slope of 0 as well, and it's not a local max or min. But at least it seems like all the local maxes and mins occur when the tangent line has a slope of 0. And so this is the local extreme point theorem. If f has a local or maximum or minimum at some point x equals c, and the derivative actually exists, then the derivative there has to be 0. What about something like this, though? This is a kind of absolute value function. For this function, it does have a local minimum right here at the point, but there, f prime of, if we say that's c, f prime of c does not exist. So what does that mean for us? That means that there can be local maxes and mins when there are not derivatives equal to 0. They can also occur when derivatives are undefined. And so, if we're looking for local maxes and mins, we're going to define something called a critical point. These are points where local maxes and mins might happen. A critical point is going to be any point in the interior of an interval where f prime is 0 or f prime does not exist. If either one of those things happens, we might have a local max or min there. So, and then the other way around is also true. If you have a local maximum or minimum, then you must be at a critical number. So, for example, if we're asked to find all the critical numbers of this function, and they don't give us an interval, so we'll assume it's everywhere from negative infinity to infinity, then what would we do? Well, that means we're looking for the places where f prime of x equals 0 or f prime of x does not exist. So let's find f prime of x. We need to use the product rule. So the derivative of x to 3/5 is 3/5 x to the negative 2/5. We keep the 4 minus x plus x to the 3/5, and then the derivative of 4 minus x is negative 1. So taking the derivative there wasn't so hard, but now we have to figure out where it equals 0 and where it doesn't exist. Well, where it doesn't exist is pretty straightforward because when we're looking around here, everything is essentially a polynomial. Here we're taking a fifth root, so fifth roots aren't an issue. We're allowed to take odd roots of everything, even roots we can only take of positive numbers. We don't have any logs to worry about. The only other thing here is this negative exponent means that we're in the bottom. So this is really like 1 over x to the 2 fifths. So this does mean that x to the 2 fifths cannot equal 0. So x cannot equal 0. So that's one critical point, x equaling 0. Because when x equals 0, f prime of x does not exist. And x equals 0 is allowed in the original equation. But what about when this equation equals 0? How do we solve for that? Well, this is tricky algebra. What we're going to do is I'm going to factor out an x to the negative 2 fifths out of this equation. And that means that in the first term, I'm left with 3 fifths times 4 minus x. And in the second term, I have pulled out a negative exponent. So usually when you pull out like a regular exponent, you're pulling out a positive number, so you subtract that. Now we're pulling out a negative number, so we're actually going to add it. So we're going to have x to the 3 fifths plus 2 fifths times negative 1. Now it turns out that 3 plus 2 fifths is just 1. This simplifies to x to the negative 2 fifths times 3 fifths 4 minus x minus x. So simplifying just a little bit more, we get x to the negative 2 fifths is 12 fifths minus 3 fifths x minus another x, so that'd be another 5 fifths x. So minus 8 fifths x equals 0. So now a function can only equal 0 if one of its factors equals 0. So this either equals 0 or this equals 0. But x to the negative 2 fifths, that's 1 over x to the 2 fifths, which can't equal 0 because the top is always 1. In fact, a fraction can only equal 0 when its top equals 0. So that leaves us with 12 fifths minus 8 fifths x equals 0. Multiplying 3 by 5, we have 12 minus 8x equals 0, or 8x equals 12, or x equals 12 eighths, which is the same as 3 halves. So we have two critical points, and they occur at x equals 0, that was where the derivative did not exist, and x equals 3 halves.